Good morning, everybody.
That was pretty good.
Well, it's a passing grade. If you would stand with me, take your hymnals, turn to page number five. Page number five in your hymnals will sing, "Oh, worship the King." Page number five in your hymnals, "Oh, worship the King." We'll just sing the first, second, and last verses this morning. All together on that first verse, number five.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His power and His love. My shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion in splendor and girded with praise. Tell of His might and sing of His grace, whose robe is alive, whose skin of His face, His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is His path
on the wings of the storm.
On the last verse.
Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in Thee do we trust, nor blindly to fail. Thy mercies, how tender, how far to the end. Our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
Amen. Please remain standing for scripture reading.
This morning's scripture is 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng. Blend with ours your voices in the triumph song. Glory, laud, and honor unto Christ the King. This through countless ages men and angels sing. 2 Timothy 2, verses 1 through 5. As we begin,
there, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. Thou, therefore, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strive lawfully. Amen.
Morning again. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we are so thankful that we can come here today again, apart from the world, to gather as your people, as your church, to hear from your word the things that you would have for us to equip us in our lives of faith to be able to bring you glory and honor. We cherish this time, Father. And we don't take it lightly. We're here to serve, to honor you, and to receive the things that you would have for us to receive. Please, Father, help us pay attention, to open our ears and our mouths wide, that we might receive it by faith, and that it would accomplish your will and your purpose in our lives. Bless our pastor, Father. Use him for this glory. Use him for this honor. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. Take your hymnals again. Turn to page 418. Page 418. I know whom I have believed. Page 418. And as always, make sure those cell phones are off. Page 418. We're going to sing the first, second, fourth, and fifth verses.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me hath made. I know not what of good or ill may be reserved for me, of weary days or golden days.
Before his face I see.
But I know. Straight from the Word of God. It's good stuff. If you would all stand with me and take your hymnals, turn to page 422, I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary. Page 422, we'll sing all three verses. I am persuaded that he is able, a hill called Mount Calvary. Page 422.
there are things as we travel this shifting sands that transcend no other reason of man. But the things that matter the most in this world, they can
sing that third verse, and we're going to have the instruments drop out on the chorus, all together on the third.
I believe that this life with its great mysteries surely someday will come to an end. But faith will conquer the darkness and
sing it out now.
I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. I'll believe whatever the cost. And when time has surrendered and earth is no more, I'll still cling to that old rugged cross.
Amen.
Boy, that's good. That's good. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God for your voices. Your voices are the key here in worship to the Lord. Thank you for singing so well. Let's bow for prayer and ask the Lord to bless our time together. Lord of heaven, oh, it's so good to hear your people washed clean by your precious blood sing songs of Zion. What a wonder it is that you can take sinners and make them into saints by your power and give them a new song, so that they would lift up their voice in the house of God and ring the bells of heaven. Thank you, Lord, for a church like this. I pray you'd bless us today. You'd bless the preaching of your word. Help me, Lord, do what I need to do in your power and in your strength, not in the arm of the flesh. We ask that the Spirit of God would meet with us. Penetrate the clouds of confusion, the clamoring voices, Lord, of the pop Christian movement. I pray you'd help us to be people of the book. Help us to that end. Bless us, Lord, now. Bless the gifts of your sweet people. Thank you, Lord, for their faithfulness and their cheerfulness in giving. We pray your abundant blessings, Lord, upon those who are unable to be with us because of health issues. Lord, those who are out traveling around the nation, even the world. And we pray, Father, that you bring them safely back with us. We thank you, Father, for this ministry and all that it entails the world over. And we pray that you'd help us to build on for your honor and for your glory. In Jesus' name, I pray these things. Amen.
Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast brought
I wish just for a minute we could have Jocelyn in here with us. Earlier when they were going through their song and practicing, of course she's standing in the back of Brother Garrett and standing in his arms. And boy, she had the biggest grin watching her mama up there sing so proud. She loves her mama and she loves her daddy. Oh, she's a joy. We have so many joyful little ones. I just asked... do we have a new baby? And of course, Gina has not had her baby yet, so we want to pray for her that she'll have a great delivery, and we'll soon have another baby. And that's good news, right? That is good news. Well, I'd like to start a short series this Lord's Day on this particular morning. The title of the series in this message is Worship by Will or by the Word. Worship by will or worship by the Word, of course, the Word of God. With no apology and without hesitation, I declare the following. This is a special place. It's not just a place, it's a special place where special people are instructed out of a special book to come on a special day to worship a special God with His special Son, empowered by His special Spirit, in a special worship service for special purposes. I'll run that by again in case you want to write that down. This is a special place where special people who are instructed out of a special book to come on a special day to worship a special God with His special Son, empowered by His special Spirit in a special worship service for special purposes. And I hope to develop that, of course, throughout this series. Now, how in the world could I say something so clear and so bold? Because the Bible says so. And I am a Bible believer. The Bible says so. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 3. If you don't believe the Bible is God's holy word, then you cannot be saved. You cannot worship God. You cannot know truth. You will lead an empty life and you will die. Sadly, a sorry death and spend an eternity in a godless place called hell that was prepared for Satan and his fallen angels. Anything of eternity and all spiritual things are given us from the Bible. And the Bible is the sole authority for all that we as God's children think, do, believe, and act upon by faith. It is our sole authority in what things we receive, and it has to be our sole things in what we reject. If you say yes to something, you have to be saying no to other things and put away from us and even condemn. By what authority? That sole authority. We live, we do, we go about all of our life in our Christian life and church life. By sole authority, we mean it is the only and it is the final authority. It is the only and it is the final authority of life and faith. Now, many hammers of criticism have been waged against the Word of God down through the centuries, and they've all been broken to pieces. And the Word of God still stands. Now, why does it stand? Because God said it would stand. And if God says, it shall be light, it shall be light. Whatever God has commanded, it will be so. And God has promised. So the hammers are going to continue to come, and they're still coming. And new ones come all the time. All the time. But the Word of God, at the end of the day, will still be standing, just like it's done when others have finished their deadly work in the hands of Satan and his imps. Let me give you some scriptures, and I'll get to where you are in just a few minutes. But let me give you some things about what God's Word actually says about itself. Psalm 119, verse 9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? How can a young man go about cleaning up his life and taking care of business? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. Thy singular, the word of God. By taking heed, paying attention to God's holy word. Verse 89 says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled. It's settled in heaven. Forever. Forever. Isaiah 40, verse 8, the grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Permanent. Psalm 12, 6 and 7, the words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times, that number perfection. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord, thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. Who does the preservation? God does. What does He preserve? His Word. His Word. The Lord said, recorded in Matthew 4, 4, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And that included that very quote Himself. John 1, 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 17, 17, sanctify them, set them apart, clean them up through thy truth. Thy Word is truth. You want to know what truth is? The Bible. Romans 10, 17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. John 8, 31 and 32, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on Him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth, God's word, the truth, shall make you free. John 14, 6, the Lord said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So you're already there to Paul's great words to young Timothy in the closing chapters of his life. And he said in verse 16 and 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. All scripture is given by God's breath. God breathed. God breathed, as the Apostle Paul wrote here, because it is given by God, it is profitable. God's word is profitable for what? For doctrine. Doctrine is just another word for the truth of God. Doctrine for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, so that the man of God may be perfect, meaning spiritually mature, thoroughly, completely furnished unto all good works. There's no good works that are needed that we cannot gain from heeding, listening, and obeying the Word of God by our sole authority. Now, how this breath of God is given is addressed by Peter in 2 Peter 1:21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man. There's that term will again. We'll get back to that. But holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So this young man by the name of Timothy, a man of God who was trained by his mother, praise God for her, and trained by his grandmother, praise God for her, and then later trained, of course, by the Apostle Paul, thank God for him. And he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:5. And he said, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, I am persuaded that is in thee also. Now, Timothy was trained in what? Timothy was trained in what, you ask? Well, thank you for asking. What was Timothy trained in? Go back to chapter 3, look at verse 14 and 15. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. Paul says, but continue. You've started this, but continue thou in the things that which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And that from a child thou hast known the what? The holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Now Peter, the apostle, qualified that which was given by God to the apostles in the New Testament was also to be considered the very Word of God. They accepted the Old Testament scriptures, but they were not accepting the New Testament. And Peter wanted them to know that the New Testament scriptures are as well the very Word of God. No one faced as much criticism as an apostle as the apostle Paul did. And Peter came, if you would, to the rescue of his brother and defended him and his words as the very Word of God. And let me prove it to you. 2 Peter chapter 3, catch me in verse 15. 2 Peter chapter 3, catch me in verse 15. And Peter writes, an account that the longsuffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, you thought we called just somebody brother or sister, or somebody that's kind of a strange thing. Well, it's as strange as the Bible. Brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you, as also in all his epistles, speaking of them, of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction. So Peter is saying the writings of Paul are the Word of God. Confirming himself, Peter himself, and the other apostles, Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 1, turn back over there two chapters and verse 16, he says, for we have not followed, we, these other apostles and himself, not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him on the holy mount. Verse 19, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, Whereunto you do well that you take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. What is he saying? This is God's word. Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8, For the Scripture saith, Thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn. Now that's an Old Testament quote. Then he says, And the laborer is worthy of his reward. That's interesting. The first quote, as I said, is from the Old Testament, but the second, not in the Old Testament. Where is it? It's in the Gospel of Luke. It's in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verse 7. For the laborer is worthy of his hire. So the Apostle Paul considered the very words of Luke to be the very word of God. Peter wrote to the readers who should remember the commandments of the Lord and the Savior through his apostles. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 2. He says that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets. And so don't discount the Old Testament. Yes, that's the word of God. And of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. He's qualifying that what they have taught to be the very word of God. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 37, If any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. In other words, the word of God. The word of God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God. They received it not as the word of these New Testament preachers, the apostles, but as it was in fact the very word of God, which effectively worketh also in you that believe. John clearly said in 1 John, do you see how broad this is? John clearly said in 1 John 4, 6, We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. What's he saying? We're giving you the very word of God. Last but not least, the writer of the book of the Revelation. Of course, John makes an express claim to divine inspiration. At the beginning of the book, John writes of what follows is the revelation that he received from God. And he said in chapter 1, verse 1 down through verse 3, if you want to catch me there, you'll have time. The revelation of Jesus Christ, he says, which God gave unto him. God gave John His word to be delivered unto the masses. And this is what we're reading yet today. The very word of God. To show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he said and signified it by his angel unto his servant John, who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ and of all things that he saw. Blessed is he that readeth. Now the reason he's blessed is because he's reading the word of God. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. So I say again, this is a special place where special people who are instructed out of a special book. Instructed out of a special book. To come on a special day, the Lord's Day, to worship a special God. With his special son, with the aid and empowerment of a special spirit, in a special worship service. People say, well, I can worship anytime, anywhere. Not in this way you can't. Not in this way you can't. This is something special, see, for special purposes. So the book of God, the B-I-B-L-E, the book of God, the Holy Bible, is the one and only source which regulates how we do our worship unto God. It is this one and only book that is given by the inspiration of Almighty God. Only one. Preacher on his deathbed said, son, get the book. He said, daddy, what book? And he said, son, there's only one, the book. Get the book. Given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. Now, in this world of humanity, which we all paddle our little boats around in, I do expect that you're human. Your wife may not think that you're human, but I really expect that you're probably human. There are two different views on who gets to determine what we do in this special place called church. There are two different prevailing views. One position is known as the regulative view, and the other is known and taught as the normative view. You hear the term regulate in the first term. The regulative view holds that the Word of God alone is the sole authority. And so the Word of God alone determines how we are to worship God in corporate worship. Being as God who is to be worshiped, He gets to determine how we do this thing we call church, a special place that comes together for corporate worship of this God. So God alone gets to decide. God alone gets to decide. It's not a matter of a vote. God alone gets to decide how we do worship. Not humanity, not leadership of churches, not a synod, not elders, not pastors, not deacons. No one other than God gets to determine how he will be worshiped. You got that? It's very important. The Second London Baptist Confession of 1689 says this, quote, "The acceptable way of worshiping the true God is instituted by himself, and so limited by his own revealed will that he may not be worshipped according to the imagination or devices of men, nor the suggestions of Satan under any visible representation, or any other way not prescribed in the Holy Scriptures." End quote. Very good. Now, the normative view is not entirely opposite, to be fair, do you know? It's not entirely opposite, but yet it is on the other end, which holds people, even maybe well-intentioned, even humble people, get to determine how they worship the Lord in corporate worship, how they go about doing church. But people get to decide. If they think drama is cool and really helps, they can do that. If they think interpretive dancing is the cool thing to do, perfectly fine, perfectly fine. If they think, well, you know, mosh pits are the thing to do, the bumping around in the front of the church like they do in some of these crazy rock concerts, that's okay too. If they think screaming and kicking and foaming at the mouth is good, they throw that in. If they think that lights and smoke and all of that that's thrown in to bring about sensationalism, if they think that really brings out the spirit, the feeling of worship as they see fit, they say that's just fine. Now, in other words, if the Bible, the position is, if the Bible doesn't clearly say you should not do that, they think it's fair game. If the Bible doesn't say anything about it, they think, well, if the Bible doesn't condemn it, It's okay for us to go ahead and use our own creativity, our own imagination, and our own expectations and our own devices. It's okay for us to go ahead and do that. That's where we are today. I said, that's where we are today. Now, to strive to be intellectually honest, you hear that all the time in smart people like yourself. Well, to be intellectually honest, with common folk, that just means honest. I don't see how you can change that too much. Both sides like to define one another. And, you know, this side likes to define that side, and that side likes to define this side. Because they like to make them sound wrong, and they like to make them sound wrong. And that's just a human equation that's pretty universal. Would you agree with that? That's pretty much how just most people roll. You know, if I want to buy a new shotgun, you know, I can really soup up the good reasons as to why I need to do that, you know. My wife would be on the opposing position, of course, with that. Some who say they believe in a regulative view of worship say, well, wait a minute, you old-fashioned people, you old fundamentalists, you old fuddy-duds out there, wait just a minute, because dancing and loud cymbals were used in worship, and you don't allow that. And they make the case that that should be allowed. And they point to Psalm 149 and 150. But I will show you in this series that those instruments that they desire so much and how they desire they be played so much were entirely restricted from corporate worship services, even in that time. They conveniently leave that out or just are so simply not aware of the fact. They were not allowed. They were not allowed in the house of God. And I'll prove that to you. Those things were forbidden by God to happen in corporate worship in the house of God. They missed something critical. Bigly. I miss that a little bit, don't you? Yeah. Bigly. And I'll show you that. I'll show it to you. It's amazing what a little Bible study can do for you. I said it's amazing what a little Bible study can do for you. It's amazing how many people claim to be professionals at all of this on blogs and all of that stuff, you know, podcasts, that seem to hardly know very little about such things. I will show you, though we, New Heights Baptist Church, we adhere to the regulative view, there are clearly some, but few liberties allowed even by our Lord Himself. And if we're going to be honest, we have to deal with those things, right? I think so, to have integrity. For instance, worship at the synagogues. And the synagogues were not commanded in the Old Testament, were they? But we know the Lord went to synagogue, even taught the Bible in synagogue. Or what about the Feast of the Dedication in John chapter 10? Which came about, of course, in the Maccabean period, the intertestamental period. But yet we find the Lord in John chapter 10 going to the temple at the Feast of the Dedication, known as the Feast of Lights, the Festivity of Lights, otherwise known as Hanukkah. Ever heard of that? Well, that's not in the Bible, but it's found in John chapter 10. What about that? Does that give us a license to just go to the other end and say, okay, whatever we want, we get to do? We'll get into that. When you see billboards which say, come experience our worship, we want to make you feel a certain way. No, we want to teach you certain things in faith. We want you to feel a certain thing, like up with people, you know, and get your lighters out, you know. You can know they likely fall into the camp which says they get to decide how to do worship, the normative view. When they have dramas in the worship services, you can just bet that they are following the normative view of worship, of this position. They believe if it works to them, whatever it takes, if it works, it's all good.
So the end justifies, we'll fill it in, the end justifies the means. Now I shared just the other night, God is orderly and he wants things to be done decent and in order. Is that so? That's so. Both things, decent and in order, both of those things are pleasing to the Lord. The Apostle Paul, writing to the confused carnal church at Corinth, said this in his first letter to them, introducing and correcting those things who were violating the Lord's Supper, all right, and by turning it into a feast and really pigging out on the communion bread. That's what they were doing. They were turning that thing into something never intended by God for it to be. And the Apostle Paul said, don't do that. Well, that's kind of my interpretation of what he said. Look at verse 34 of chapter 11, 1 Corinthians 11:34. He says, if any man hunger, that's not what this is about. This is not a meal to fill your belly. This is a meal to fill your soul. See the difference? You've made this out to be a feast, and it's not a feast. This is of faith. If any man hunger, let him eat at home, that you come not together unto condemnation. Then he says, and the rest, not only that needs to be corrected, regulated. You with me? Then he says, and the rest, there's other things, and the rest will I set in order when I come. So there's still some things that need to be put in order. Right? It's exactly what it says. This great church planner, the Apostle Paul, wrote to Titus. Go over to Titus chapter 1, verse 5. This is one of also his younger preacher boys that he trained, not so young as Timothy, but yet his son in the faith. And he left him in Crete. And in Titus chapter 1, verse 5, he says, this is the reason I left you in Crete. You with me? Say amen if you're there. Titus chapter 1, verse 5. The Apostle Paul says, for this cause left I thee in Crete, thee singular, this one preacher, I left thee in Crete that thou, singular, shouldest set in order. Set in order the things that are wanting, the things which are needing to be set in order. I left you there. You are responsible. You are in charge. Set these things in order. That sounds like regulation to me. I said, that sounds like regulation to me. Doesn't it to you? He says, and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee. So Titus was to set things in order. Whose order? God's order. Not even Paul's order, God's order. Paul's following God's instruction and passing it along to the younger preacher boys. God's order. So you mean, preacher, you mean that God has his own order when it comes to corporate worship? Yeah. That's exactly what I mean. That's exactly what I mean. You know, that really shouldn't surprise. I don't want to be condescending. I don't want to be a smart aleck, but it just, that shouldn't be a surprise to anybody who's read the Bible. I mean, how can you read the Bible, even just Genesis? How about first five chapters of Genesis and come away with any other opinion about the matter? I'm not sure how you can distance yourself from that truth. Titus was to set us all in order. Turning your Bibles to Colossians chapter 2, this is a key passage. Paul deals with problems that are caused by excessive traditions of the Jews, all right, that elevated their own traditions higher than even the Word of God and say, you have to do all of this stuff, all right? That's one of the problems they had done. It's one of the problems. Also, the Jews had failed to realize that Christ was the fulfilling substance of the shadows of many things in the law, and so that those things were no longer relevant as they had been fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. And no longer, you don't need to bring a little lamb, was talking to the guys last night. We have a rooster farm just two doors down from our house. And I said, boy, if we could sacrifice roosters, man, I'd be in the fix, boy. We had to come to church and man, I'd have a rooster and I'd have less crowing in the neighborhood every day. I'll tell you that. Don't tell my neighbor I said that, though, you know, poor roosters. But they had elevated their traditions, and they had missed the mark on all of the shadows that pointed to Christ, and they kept insisting on chasing after the shadows instead of enjoying the freedom that they had in Jesus Christ. That was two problems for the Jews. And then there was another group and others that kind of similar to them called the Gnostics. And they were supposed to Mr. Big Britches of those days, and they thought they had outsmarted everybody, including God. And they had their own way of going about things. And so what does the Apostle Paul do? Well, he gets out that book. He gets out that sword, and he starts cutting, man. That's what preachers do. They cut with the Word of God. That's what somebody the other day said, when you preach, I feel like you're speaking just to me. And I said, I am. That's not only you. But I am speaking to you. It's the Word of God that sticks you. It's the Word of God that cuts sharper than any two-edged sword. So he's dealing with a number of problems in this one passage. In both cases, the Jews were wrong and the Gnostics were wrong as well, simply because they were not following the teaching of God's Word. And when we don't follow the teaching of God's Word, guess what? We're not right. We're wrong. Beginning in verse 16 of chapter 2, Paul said, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of a new moon or of the Sabbath, not day, but days. Several different holidays, holy days, Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. So that's where the Jews had their major hang-up, okay? They had failed to see the reality. The Messiah had come in the Lord Jesus Christ, and all of those things pointed to the Christ. This, of course, takes aim at the inflated Jews. Then the Gnostics, they catch it, kind of like the backhand, you know, whack. He says, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding to those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. That's called university professors tenured. You're welcome. And not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. Wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are ye subject to ordinances that they, of course, have manufactured? Touch not, taste not, handle not, which all are to perish with the using after the commandments and doctrines of men, which things have indeed a show of wisdom in, here's our word, will worship. They have indeed a show, an appearance of wisdom in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. So in all these things, Paul says, there may be a shadow. There may seem to be something from man that has merit here, but it is no profit to the soul. Why? Because it didn't come from God. So if you drink after this well, it's living water. But if you drink out of this well, though it has a sign that says living water, but it is not the living water of God, you're going to be poisoned. And that's what he's saying. He's drawing a line. And preachers are pretty good about drawing those lines. Whose side are you on? You ever heard that? The great prophet Moses. So no profit to the soul in a religion or worship which is worthless to God. No profit. Though you might think there is. Be convinced. I'm sincere. Yeah, but you're sincerely wrong. All because it is a worship contrived by human will as opposed to the Word. Human will as opposed to the Word of God. So for people to decide what is to be done in corporate worship instead of allowing God's Word to regulate corporate worship towards God as God prescribed, this is what, if they say, let mankind, let them do it. They've studied this out. I'm sure they have. But not with the Word. They studied it out by asking other human beings. That is called, in the Scripture, will worship. Will worship. Simply self-determining worship of men, which is worthless to God, though the practitioners may humble themselves and even have what has the appearance of success. The goal of worship and sacrifice, according to God's word, is not to please men, but to please God. So if you're on God's side, you should be very interested in what it would mean by the Word of God to please God instead of pleasing men, including your little self. Including your little self. Nowhere is this more evident of the contrast that we see in Genesis chapter 4. Which we're going to get into next week. As I said, you don't have to read but five chapters to get into it to see what we're talking about here. How can you read the Bible and say mankind gets to make it up as he goes when God's already clearly, overwhelmingly spoken to the issue? I think somebody's not reading the book. I remember Jim Baker, that charlatan, remember him? And he went to prison for his shenanigans. He finally in prison, I guess, had some extra time on his hands and he started reading the Bible and he found out God didn't have a lot of good things to say about money anyway. You're leading all these people and you've never even read the Bible. Amazing. 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 Do you know where contemporary Christian services originated? Do you know where it came from? Do you know? Different men and women, they decided we need to find out how we can get people out in the community to come to church. So they went out to the people in the community. They didn't go to God's Word. They went out to the people of the community and said, we have a survey and we'd like to know, if you were to decide to go to church, what would you like to have in church that you would attend? And they compiled all of this list and all this data. And then they turned it into slick men who can write good books and allure the masses in. And so then they started having conferences called church growth seminars. And if you are really interested in building your church, this is what you need to do. Well, what do you do? Well, you're supposed to go out to your community and find out what they think you should be doing, what church should look like, and what kind of music and everything else that should go on in the house of God. And they said, well, we don't want it to look like a church. We don't want it to sound like a church. We don't want it to taste like a church. But that's what we want. And so they started turning their churches into entertainment centers. And it looks more like a nightclub than it does the house of God. In fact, they don't want their church to look anything like an old-fashioned church. They don't want any pews. They don't want a steeple. No, no. We want to make this thing look like a bowling alley. Did I say that? It's like Urkel. Did I do that? Did I go there? That's a sister church in town. I hope it is. But it still looks like a bowling alley. Call it. I'm sorry. There you go. Ugliest building in town, second only to the center over here with the library, you know. Looks like a Chuck E. Cheese joint over there, you know. Good night. But that's where it all originated. They didn't go to the book. They didn't go to God to find out what God said. This is what I want you to do if you're going to worship me. They went to lost people in the community and then they organized all of that together and they started a movement called the Church Growth Movement. And that became the popular thing among churches, and they bought it hook, line, and sinker. And they went and said, boy, we got to do that. We got to make church cool, man. Cool. We got to have a band. We got to have a big drum set up there. We got to rock out, man. We got to be cool. Pastor threw away this, and the next thing you know, they're dressing with a little golf shirt, maybe some shorts on, and flip-flops, shower shoes, I call them. They're really cool, man. They're really cool. Wait a minute. Man, you stink. Well, you didn't even take a bath. Well, we're going to get there. Exodus chapter 19, you'll find they had to clean themselves up before they went to worship. Oh. They had to dress up to go to work. Oh. You mean all that's in the book? It's like Prego spaghetti sauce. It's in there. But if you're not interested in the book, this is what you get. And next thing you know, the vast majority of churches around our nation, around the world, in fact, have followed all of that pattern. And next thing you know, it looks just like the world. Going that route, going out to the community and talking to people, even well-intentioned people, that's not my point, well-intentioned people, is a direct attack on the sufficiency of the Word of God. What it's saying is God's Word is not enough to tell us what we need to do to be saved and happy. God's Word's not enough. We're going to reject God's Word. We've got to go to some other pasture. We've got to turn to Egypt. And that's what they did. By the thousands. Will ye leave also? Do you believe God's Word gives you everything you need in life to be complete, blessed, and saved? Yes or no? Do you believe that? Then why should you go anywhere else? To whom shall we go? Did Peter say, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words. To whom shall we go? Do you believe God, who desires to be worshipped, would leave out instructions then? Just read through the book of Leviticus, if you may. Read through that book and find out how many details you can come up with exactly how God said things ought to be done. And then you suggest to me that God has no intention of regulating corporate worship. It's going to be a hard sell, my friend. You think God would just leave it to us to decide how we're going to do this thing called worship of Him, the one and only holy true God? He's just going to leave us to our own devices to do the best you can. And if you think that's a good idea, throw it in, man, throw it in. Or are you going to think that there's likely going to be some things that God says, I would like to regulate these things. And if you're going to worship me, this is how you need to do it. Now, are there some differences between your worship out in the world and as you abide under the shadow of the earth, the umbrella, the firmament of heaven? Yes. There's a big difference what you do out there and what is to be done in the very house of God. And there was a difference with the nation of Israel at the time. About the closest thing that I can think about the holidays, the holy days, and many of the festive days that they celebrated, not in the house of God, but out in the streets, is our 4th of July picnics and parades that we have. And here you have the dancing maidens called cheerleaders. This land is your land, this land is my land. July 4th parade. Perfectly legitimate. Perfectly supported. Out there. Out there and not in here. So, singing songs of faith, psalms, hymns, spiritual psalms, yes. Interpretive dancing, no. You say, well, aren't we going to vote on that? No. Now, what regulates that? Is it just my whim? And indeed, some who maintain that I follow the regulative teaching of the Word of God pertaining to worship, and they just pretty much just do what they want and just pretend that they're actually following that. Yeah, there's some of those cats out there. There's some people like that. I'm not trying to be one of those, but I'm just admitting to you there are some people out there like that that weaken the case. We'll deal with those two exceptions, the synagogue and the festivity of lights. We'll deal with that. And by the way, in the similarity with our celebrating and having Christmas services. Huh. Yeah, we'll deal with that. But when it all comes down to it, you're either going to be on one side or the other. You're going to believe God's word has the authority and it has the sole authority to regulate how we do church. Or you're going to be on the other side that says, whatever we decide to do, that's good with God. Really? Let's stand. Lord of heaven, we need instruction. You said of your children that my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Lord, and we need to understand what you have regulated so that we can follow your way from your book and not our will in how we worship. Lord, somebody here today and they do not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, we invite them to come. And we'd be so happy to show them out of your word how they can be born again, how they can be forgiven of all their sin, how they can be made righteous before God and live forever in heaven when they pass from this earth. But Lord, I pray that you would bless this short series, Lord, and help us to be a people of your word and never our own will. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Page 241, Jesus Paid It All is our hymn of invitation. Page 241, I hear the Savior say.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me. Paid it all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Amen. Well, just a couple quick things just for your information, I guess, FYI, I do have the picture stuff set up in the office for updates for the directory. So I'll have that up there for the next few weeks if you need a new picture taken for the directory for our use. It doesn't go out to the public. It's just for our use here, phone numbers, emails, birthdays, and all that stuff. That just come and see me. I'll be available 10, 15 minutes after the service. If you don't know, if you need a new picture, just come by the office, look at your picture, or look at all your information. Oh, I don't live there anymore. Well, come and tell me so that way I can change it, all right? I don't know unless you come tell me. So that's going to be available. Also, we have several things coming up on the bulletin there. Just keep a lookout for that. And then we got choir practice tonight and other things going on. So let's go ahead and be dismissed in prayer and God bless you for being here. Lord, we thank you so much just for your word this morning. Thank you for just that it has and that you've given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, as it says there in the Bible, according to Peter. And Lord, we just thank you for just for giving that to us so that we can know what we need to do and how we need to do it. And in order to glorify you and to reverence and respect you in everything that we do and everything that we say, Lord, both inside the house of God and outside, how to live our lives here and out there. Lord, help us to obey your word, not just to be hearers, but be doers also, and glorifying you in that. Bless us this week and help us to be witnesses of you in our lifestyle and also with our words, Lord. Give us the boldness that we need. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.